Occasionally people come up to me and say, Chuck, when are you going to show us a hot rod? Well, you have found Rides with Chuck, and in this video, we take a close look at a 1940 Ford DeLuxe Hot Rod, and we go for a ride.
The car was painted 4 times. It was yellow when I got it. I repainted it yellow lacquer. And then a friend of mine painted it in his garage, actually in his brother's garage, black. So this time I for sure wanted the car to be black, but as you know, a car has to be really straight to be black. And the body was definitely nice enough. I had this hood for ages. I probably had this hood for 30 years. I bought it from a friend who had a couple of 40s that he was restoring. And what's really cool about it is it has 112 louvers in it. And louvers are no big thing, but these hoods are really difficult to louver because they're curved. And a louver press has like a male and a female die that just punches the louvers. It's relatively easy to do on a flat piece of metal, but like on the curves of the hood here, it's really tough to do. And also there's like bracing, like framework inside of the hood that had to be cut out to put the hood on the louver press. So this was done decades ago. Like I say, I've had it for probably 30 years, and I don't know how long my friend has had it for. And I also had the inside of the hood metal finished, so there's no plastic, there's no Bondo or anything in the hood. In the process of punching the louvers, it might look okay on the outside, but then you'll see some work on the inside. So inside the hood is almost as nice as the outside of the hood, and that's what I was looking for. The car itself, like I was saying, the firewall was kind of butchered up, and so the firewall is smooth. The battery is located underneath the frame to kind of clean up the firewall a little bit. Same thing with the master cylinder. This is a new crate motor from GM. It's a 300 horse 350. Even though it says Oldsmobile, kind of the intent of building this car is to look like a hot rod from the 60s. I would call it timeless, you know, black and white walls and louvers and a white interior. It's really not dated. And so I got these from the aftermarket from a company called Technostalgia. They're Oldsmobile type valve covers that fit a Chevrolet engine, and the same with the Batwing air cleaner. It's kind of disguising the Chevy engine to look like an Olds engine of the 60s, something that you would put in a hot rod in that time, kind of before the small block Chevy came out. But just visually, it looks a lot like it. If you look a little deeper, the intake is different and the exhaust ports are different. So if you look at it real closely, you'll see it's a Chevy. And the intent is not to fool anybody. It's just to kind of fit the type of car I wanted. It's a real traditional car. It rides great. It drives great, but it's nothing fancy. It still has a Super Bell beam axle. Split wishbones, no independent front end, but it does have sway bars and gas shocks and urethane bushings, so it drives just fine. When I built the car ages ago, I put mid-50s F100 brakes on it because they're 12-inch diameter drums and a little better braking, but they're still drums. And they worked fine, but years ago I put discs on the front just for reliability. I suppose with the drums, they're fine driving around town, but a couple panic stops, and you'd much rather have the disc brakes. So chassis-wise, it's pretty simple. Camaro rear end. It does have a 4-speed, a Muncie 4-speed. In my opinion, hot rods have 3 pedals. I don't particularly like the shift, but that's my interpretation of a hot rod, that it has to have a clutch. So that's pretty much it for the chassis. The body, I took dozens, probably hundreds of pictures of cars, 39s and 44s that had flames on it. Like with so many cars, if the flame job is done nice and tastefully, it looks great. If it's not, it looks kind of bad. So I knew what I didn't want based on pictures. And I couldn't be more pleased with the job that Bill did with these flames. Again, Route 66 Motorsports here in New Lenox outside of Chicago did all the body and paint. And I believe it was either 2000 or 2001 that this was done. And it's 2019, halfway through 2019, and the car looks like it was done last month. So it's both the paint and the interior, which we'll get to in a little bit. I couldn't be happier. Actually, I joked with both of them that I wanted this work to last into my retirement, and I've been retired going on 5 years, so I guess we've accomplished that, huh? Like I say, the car still looks great. Okay. The interior was done, again, locally out of Chicago by Schober's Custom Auto Interiors in Newark. I'm equally happy with the work that's been done here. The same thing, it was done the same time the body was done almost 20 years ago, and it looks like new. I knew I wanted a white or off-white type of interior, kind of to fit with the period of the car. And Dave was great. We talked about different materials, and I wanted it in vinyl or marine type of vinyl because I drive it a lot, and the car has no power accessories, no power steering, no power brakes, no heat, no defrost, no air. Don't need those things, but driving it, if you are driving it like on a rainy day, there's a lot of humidity that forms inside the car, and that's why I wanted to go with vinyl, you know, something that would hold up to the elements. And like I say, everything looks like brand new. This car was, and I always get confused, your viewers will know the difference, I'm sure, between a business coupe and an opera coupe. The body outside appears the same. The difference is one version has a spare tire like behind the rear window that's up and down like this, vertical. And there's a big brace that holds it, goes from the window down to the trunk. And others don't have that, it's a complete pass-through, so that determines the type of seat you have. This car does have the brace, so it had a split seat and two jump seats back here. I've got some jump seats, but we never put them in because it's not a split seat, because I looked everywhere for an original coupe seat that was split, and I couldn't find one. And of course, a few weeks after it went to the upholsterer, I found one, but you know that goes. The other type of seat had a flip up back, and everything was, it was like a clear path all the way through the back of the car, where I suppose like a salesman could put a lot of their goods and stuff. So anyhow, it looks like there's a pass-through there, but that's just a, it's Velcroed on. It's for storage and other stuff. Okay. There's also a panel. If we go around to the trunk, we can, those are not factory, by the way. A very nice aftermarket here, because this deck lid is extremely heavy. It hit me in the head a few times when the original springs were kind of weak. It's I'd swear it's 200 pounds. It probably isn't, but it's very, very heavy. The same thing here. There's a panel that Velcros in, and there's a spare tire and room for tools and all that stuff. I've removed the tools here. But yeah, the Schober's did a wonderful job on this. Like I say, it's held up extremely well. There's even some storage down here. There's a trailer hitch on it too, because I've restored a 1936 Mullins trailer. It's a real steel trailer. Actually, it's still titled and licensed in California where I bought it from. I don't take it out too much, but it matches the car. I originally bought the body and frame, I think, in 1980. And the original plan was to put it together and flip it in a year, but that was almost 40 years ago now. Originally, it had paint on it and a partial interior, and that was about it. And we threw kind of a junk motor together, and that lasted a long, long time. As a matter of fact, it's still in my garage. And just made the car roadworthy, and then over the years improved it and improved it. It's on its second engine, second interior, fourth paint job, several fuel pumps, a couple of alternators, three sets of tires. And it has somewhere in the neighborhood of, I'd say, between 110,000 and 120,000 miles as a street rod. Since I built the car. Reason I'm not sure is there's a second set of instruments that I put in. Now the odometer has about 63 or 64,000 miles on it, and the one before had somewhere around 50. I sold it to swap meet, so I'm not sure. See, one of the benefits of being retired is I have all this spare time now, and I had a map, and I was looking for something. And I was thinking, gee, I wonder how many states I've been in this car. And I started putting pennies on each of the states. And it's been through 25 states. Been coast to coast, several trips to the West Coast, to California. Actually, both coasts. It's been York, Pennsylvania, Columbia, South Carolina, for street rod events. So it's been, and knock on wood, it's been virtually trouble-free.
How many years it's been since I've chirped the tires in this thing? Many.
Thanks for the ride, John.
Thanks, Chuck. My pleasure. That was a fun 40 years, and I won't see another 40, but however long, it's a keeper for me. And as they say, we're just caretakers of these cars, so we'll pass it on to the next one.